Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel where we create photo realistic assets together. Welcome back to this course, and in today's video we're going to talk about how to add believable grunge and dirt onto our asset. So to do that, first of all, you have to decide what kind of dirt and grime that can be on your asset. For this asset, I'm imagining it's a drone but flying pretty close to the ground, so there's going to be some dirt. I'm imagining this thing is stored outside mostly, so there's going to be some water damage and some rust. And when you arrange those different kind of dirt and grime, I would suggest arrange them according to how they were laid out in real life. Such as dust is probably going to be always on top of everything. The next step you have to do is to collect tileable textures for those dirt material, but also collect useful stencils for how those material will look. And we will also be using some sort of combination of procedural and hand painting and lay down the dirt in a believable way. Let's get into today's process. Before I started to add the dirt and the grime, I want to add some decal onto my asset just to add more believability. Maybe this thing is used by some sort of military. I don't really have a strong concept for this, but I'm just going to add small things here and there to make it look a little bit more believable. I'm just going to put down some random numbers, some random symbol that looks like it can be on this asset. In terms of texture, it's just a white layer of paint, and I'm just painting on the mask for that layer. After I finish the decal, I want to add some breakup to it. Since this thing is looking very dirty and damaged, I'm sure the decal is getting scratched off a little bit as well. So, the first type of grime I want to add onto this asset is some kind of water damage. I was looking at this reference where they have very distinct, interesting looking water damage from the top, and that's kind of the look I'm going for. So first, I will create a new type of material. Again, I'm using something very exaggerated because I want to be able to see some detail once I paint the stencil. And this texture is mostly a rust color texture. Might be a bit of a weird choice for water damage, but I was imagining the water damage will be kind of desaturated brown color. That's why I chose this texture. My texture style is pretty heavy-handed. This is definitely just a personal choice, and you don't have to do it this way at all. So after I lay down the tileable texture, I create a mask for it, and also there's a HSV layer to change the color a little bit. And after that, I collect quite a few different stencils for water-looking damage, and I'm just gonna lay down some general area that I think this type of damage will occur. The color is looking pretty weird right now. It's very rust-like, and we can always change that later, so I'm not worried too much about it. You can probably also see that I'm trying out different stencils. When I don't like it, I erase it and try a different one. When we collect those stencils, we never know how it's gonna really look on our asset, and definitely give yourself a little bit more option. Don't feel like you are stuck with the first one you find, and actually take your time to find a few more different variety for yourself, and because you never know which one is going to work the best. I'm not using any kind of procedurally generated smart masks for this one because I think those water drips are pretty big and it's quite distinct in certain areas, and it won't be a lot of paint work, so it's not really necessary. When I'm painting those water drips, I'm thinking about how to align those drips to make it look interesting. I don't want the end of the drips all ended on the same flat line. Want to make sure there's a good variety of short ones and long ones. I also constantly zooming out to look at it from a distance and see what kind of effect does it have on my asset. After I'm happy with the drips, I'm going back into Substance Painter and try to create a procedural mask for an overall rust look. I just need the rust to be in some areas because obviously this machine is still functional. It's not going to be too rusty. Inside of Mario, I create a new layer of texture for rust, and I create a separate mask for it and imported the mask from Substance Painter. The rust color right now is pretty bright, and I'm adjusting it to a more believable level. I bought this asset off TurboSquid, so I don't really have a concept for the asset, and also I don't have a one-to-one reference of how things like rust were laid out and how water damage were laid out on such asset. I'm using the Ashley Wood toy as my main reference, and to be honest, they are not the best type of reference, and I would not suggest any of the students I mentor to use this type of reference for their asset because somebody else made it. It's not a real kind of damage. If you're still new to texturing, I would highly suggest you look for a real photo as your main reference. So what I'm doing here is that the rust mask is a little too all over the place, and I want to have a little bit more control over where the rust is. So I actually crank up my procedural maps inside of Substance Painter so it covers more area, but I also assigned a black mask to it so we don't see anything. And then I will paint in white area for the mask, for the area that I actually want the rust to show up. And for me, in my mind, wherever there's a little bit more water damage and anything that's a bit closer to the ground or anywhere the paint is chipped off more, we will see more rust. And that's where I will brush in the procedural mask. Again, I'm doing this based off my experience and just how many rust I've done in my entire career. For you, if you're still new to this, definitely look for a better reference than what I'm doing here. The next procedural mask I want to generate is for the dust. So I'm going back to Substance Painter. First, I look for a dust mask that covers more of the cavity area. And then I'm looking for another dust mask that covers more the surface area, and I combine them together. That's the type of dust mask I like to generate. In general, I think of it as something that's actually on the entire surface, almost everywhere. A little bit more in the AO and cavity area, but with a nice breakup on it, so it will break up the speck in an interesting way. The current dust mask I have right now is a little bit too thick. Based on my experience, I know if I use this one, it's gonna cover up way too much of the area. So I'm testing out some of the grunge tileable maps inside of Substance Painter and try to break up this dust mask. Once I'm happy, I'm gonna export this and look at it again inside of Mari. Before I import the dust mask, we have to lay down another layer of material for the dust. I like to use this very patterned rock texture, like any of my texture. I like how there's a lot of detail on it. Even though we're making a dust mask, most likely we will not see any of this variation, but just a force of habit. Once the mask is imported, I will link the radio transmitter node to a new radio node and plug it into the mask area of the dust material. And now we can see the dust. It's pretty strong. It's too bright, probably, so I will lower the value a little bit and see how much the dust is covering the surface and if I need to maybe break it up a little bit more. For me to have a dust layer, mostly it's for breaking up the speck. We're really gonna see it when we render the asset. So sometimes it's not super necessary that we see a lot of it in our color map. I definitely think it's doing too much to the color map. It's covering up a lot of other detail that we've created already. So I'm gonna use a tile node and tile in some breakup masks to break up the dust mask. I do that by changing the layer setting to multiply and see how is this new pattern break up the surface. Once I like the breakup, I'm gonna turn on the color maps again and see if it looks better than before. I think this level is a lot more reasonable for sure. Now we actually cannot see the dust as much anymore. I think I'm gonna crank up. I like the breakup, but I think I'm gonna crank up the brightness of the mask a little bit to see a little bit more. And now I think I'm arrived at a level that I'm happy with. That is everything I have for you today. I hope that was a helpful tutorial. In the next video, we're going to talk about the rendering process, especially rendering for texture artists. I feel like it's a little bit different than rendering for actual look dev artists, where I will be doing most of my adjustments inside of texture. If you are curious about how that works, definitely tune into the next one. And that will be the last part of this entire course. To be honest, I can't wait to move on to something else and show you guys something new. While I'm publishing this course series, I'm actually working on something that I'm super excited about and I can't wait to show you guys. I guess I will tell you what it is later. I will see you in the next one.